Over to you, Chaitanya. We have 22 participants with us.
Sure. Thanks, Himanshi. All right, so we can just get started. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today. This session of the Climate Change in Cities series takes a closer look at the EV charging infrastructure deployment in cities. So as we all know, for the government of India, electric mobility is a way to decarbonize the transport sector, which is responsible for 10.5% of total GHG emissions in India. It's also a means to energy independence, with the transport sector being responsible for consumption of 70% of all diesel and 95% of all petrol in the country. At the local level, we also know that air pollution is a tremendous challenge for Indian cities. Just yesterday, there was a report that suggests that air pollution will be reducing the life expectancy of 40% of Indians by up to 9 years even. So given the air pollution crisis that a lot of our cities are in, with zero tailpipe emissions, electric mobility is a very critical component of the toolbox to tackle this crisis as well. So while electric mobility is one of the tools within our sustainability pathway, just like we need road infrastructure before vehicles can actually get on the roads, we need charging infrastructure before electric vehicles can actually start beginning to ply. There's a lot of discussion about how there's a debate between, you know, whether electric vehicles should come first or whether charging infrastructure should come first. It's not really that much of a debate anymore. It's very clear that you do need a certain amount of infrastructure in place so that people have the confidence and have the wherewithal to buy or invest in electric vehicles, to convert their electric their fleets to electric vehicles if we're talking about commercial operations. So that's what we're looking at today. And charging infrastructure being a new type of transport and energy infrastructure requires a lot of new policies and processes, as well as coordination between different departments to be implemented. And that's what we're hoping to sort of start touching upon in the session today. So we've compiled a few key insights on how cities can implement a well-planned network of EV charging infrastructure, one which can maximize access, as well as be located in areas where high charging demand exists and be implemented in an efficient and affordable manner. So we have four presentations today, which we will be running along with in hopefully what is an interactive manner. After each presentation, we'll be taking some time for Q&A so that we can make this participative. And if you have any questions, we request you to please participate during the moderated session. Leave your questions in the chat box, for example, as well. We'll be starting with one introductory presentation of the EV Charging Infrastructure Implementation Handbook, which was launched just last month by Niti Aayog, which provides this overarching roadmap from planning to implementation of EV charging. I'll be making that presentation. After this, my colleague Rohan from WRI India will then present a methodology for assessing EV charging demand at the city level. So how do you know how much public charging to provide, and how do you plan for upgrading the electrical grid? Then Sushovan from GIZ will be presenting the key highlights of the public charging tender and the private charger empanelment tender that were put out by government agencies in Delhi in terms of actual contractual agreements and the key conditions therein for implementing charging. And finally, Mr. D.V. Ramakrishna Kumar from TS REDCO, which is the state nodal agency for charging infrastructure in Telangana, we'll speak about how they're supporting EV charging implementation in Hyderabad. So that's just a brief overview of what we're covering today. And so I'll just get started. I'm making the first presentation, and just give me a minute to share my screen. Can you see my screen, Himanshi?
Yes, it's visible.
Great, thank you. So first off, to begin with, let's talk about what the implementation gap is in EV charging. We know that the government of India has been putting out quite a few policies and guidelines to promote charging. The Ministry of Power has put out charging infrastructure guidelines and standards. The Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has put out the amendments for the model building bylaws to integrate EV charging. DHI has been running the FAME program, which offers subsidies for EVs as well as for EV charging infrastructure. But at the same time, implementation on ground is going fairly slowly. And that is because it is the state and local authorities that have the mandate to pass these regulations and to actually do the on-ground implementation. So from policy to implementation, we do notice a clear gap. So the other thing to keep in mind is that during the, I mean, even now, as we are first starting out across EV charging implementation over the past 2-3 years across FAME 1 and FAME 2, a lot of the chargers that were being implemented and a lot of the chargers that were being subsidized are very high power chargers that are meant for electric car charging. And that's a good move. When you need to start off with a skeletal system of charging infrastructure across the city, you want to make sure that you have big charging hubs that are able to cater to a minimal amount of charging activity. At the same time, when we're thinking about scaling up to the millions of chargers that might be actually needed on ground to be adequate for the entire EV transition, we notice that there's a mismatch. A lot of the vehicles on ground are going to be two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And while some of them will be doing part of their charging at home, many of them will also be charging on the streets, or where they don't have parking in their houses, they will depend on public charging. But the high-powered chargers are sort of not required for such small lightweight vehicles with small battery sizes. So what we're seeing is that there is a mismatch between the major number of vehicles, electric vehicles that will be on ground, and the major types of chargers that are being implemented. While we need the high power chargers, we're not saying those are not needed. At the same time, we do need a distributed, dense network of low power chargers that can be installed and implemented anywhere, with low land requirements, as well as low electric supply requirements. And even now, as we speak, BIS, the Bureau of Indian Standards, and the Department of Science and Technology are currently framing these standards for lightweight chargers that can fulfill a lot of the charging requirements and be more affordable. So this is what the handbook deals with. This is the handbook that was co-developed by NITI Aayog, Ministry of Power, Department of Science and Technology, and WRI India, with support from other ministries and an advisory group of industry experts. Now, this handbook, the audience is very much the implementing agencies on ground, DISCOMs, local authorities. It provides a step-by-step approach to actually build out the EV charging infrastructure roadmap, right from planning for your charging infrastructure to governing it and coordinating between the different parties governing it, as well as the implementation. I will take you briefly through the 7 chapters of the handbook. It's not possible to provide a complete overview, but the idea is to provide an orienting roadmap so that you can go back and look at the handbook in detail yourselves. The first chapter provides an overview of electric vehicle supply equipment, what AC and DC charging is, what charging modes are, what power ratings are, and what the charging standards are that govern EV charging. At the same time, it also talks about the advantages of low power charge points, which I was just briefly speaking about, which in that they are more cost efficient. They can be implemented anywhere that you have an electricity connection. You don't need heavy electrical infrastructure, and they're more financially viable because they're more affordable. Currently, while there is low usage of EV charging, you will get your return on investment faster as an investor in lower power charging points. The second chapter looks at the governance of charging itself. As I was mentioning, charging is not a transport infrastructure, it's not an energy infrastructure, it's a hybrid infrastructure. And what you're going to find is that there are a lot of authorities that are now responsible for its implementation. On ground, we've actually delineated it into policymaking and regulatory authorities and executive and implementing authorities. But on ground, when you look at it, you actually have the DISCOMs who are responsible for providing the power connections. You have the urban local bodies that are responsible for providing access to land and providing access to planning permissions. You have regional transport authorities that actually know where the EVs are coming and where charging is needed. You have many other PSUs and transit agencies and other government bodies who have access to government land that can actually be provided for charging purposes. And you have the state nodal authorities that are now in the position of trying to bring all these folks together. So the idea is that a working group that can be created at the local level for implementation can greatly enhance coordination between these parties and make the charging, planning, and implementation a lot more seamless. Now that we've talked about what charging infrastructure is and what the governance structure of it could look like, we get into the planning. So chapter three looks at setting targets for EV charging. So targets can be two types, access-based or demand-based. Access-based targets essentially say that for every 3x3 kilometers, you need to have at least one charge point, essentially saying that no matter how many EVs are in a given location, you should at least have a basic minimum level of charge points. And demand-based charging targets actually say that, okay, you have high amount of EVs here and EV charging demand here. So let's look at getting more charge points in this area than this other area. And the handbook also lays out a sort of estimation methodology for how many charges might be needed at a city level. So if you're a planner, you can use this methodology to actually do some rough calculations so that you can set your own local targets that are above and beyond the Ministry of Power targets. Chapter four then talks about the spatial planning of these charging infrastructure. At the city level, we know how many charges are needed. Now, how do we know how many are needed in each area? So there is, by doing a geospatial planning and analysis, you can actually understand based on certain indicators, which Rohan will go into in much more detail in his presentation, about how to understand where charging demand is greater and thereby how to distribute your EV charging infrastructure based on this projected demand. And at the same time, alongside planning, you're going to need to learn to start integrating EV charging into your long-term policies. So if you have urban parking policies, you need to integrate EV charging to ensure that all street charging or all off-street public charging should have access to EV charging. If you're doing urban planning or land use planning in a given area, you need to understand again how to allocate a certain amount of space and a certain amount of infrastructure for EV charging. So this needs to become a regular component of our street infrastructure planning, transport infrastructure planning, as well as energy infrastructure planning. And that brings us to chapter five, which then turns from spatial to the electrical infrastructure, essentially talking about the two or three different ways by which any customer can, at the site level, get access to electricity for EV charging. And at the same time, the evolving role of the DISCOMs in providing power connections and the role of the different regulations and policies on EV charging. For example, tariffs and how EV tariffs are now a new line item or category in the DISCOM consumer basket. Chapter six sort of steps back a little. It's still about the electrical grid infrastructure, but essentially what it's looking at is not at the site level, but the impact of EV charging at the grid level. In the current situation with the current number of EVs on ground, it's not a big issue, but as the number of EVs grow, you know that the charging EV charging load at the local level is going to be significant. And while it may not have an impact in terms of the overall macro picture, we have enough generation capacity to be able to manage EV charging. At the same time, we know that our distribution infrastructure at the transformer level can be very low power and low capacity. And we need to understand how we can start strengthening that to withstand the loads of EV charging. And finally, the chapter, the handbook ends with an overview of EV charging implementation. So what are the typical roles within an implementation model? Typical charging implementations are not just by one player. You're going to need to have someone to procure the charging infrastructure, someone to provide the land, someone to provide the electricity, someone to actually come and install the charger and set up the software, and then someone to actually operate it and offer the services to customers. And in its implementation, what we found is that there are three different types of models typically. And Sushovan will actually, I think, go into greater detail into the government-driven model when he's talking about the public charging tender by Delhi. And the three different types of models are where either the government is leading the planning and procurement of EV chargers, where it is consumers like apartment buildings or malls or other institutional structures that require charging on their premises for their inhabitants, or the service provider model, where charge point operators, who are the people doing the business of EV charging, aggregate land, get the necessary energy supply, and create a public charging network. So that's about it. This is just, again, as I said, a very brief overview of the handbook itself. And if you have any questions, please do go ahead and reach out and let us know, and go through the handbook if you would like to. I'll stop here. And I'm happy to take about one or two questions at this stage before we move to the next presentation, if there are any.
If you have any questions, please feel free to drop them in the chat box so that Chaitanya can take and answer them. If not, then we will move to another session in a minute.
Yeah, if you don't have any questions, we can go on and we can move to having questions all together at the end as well. So,
I think we should go on. Yeah.
All right, great. So Rohan, I invite you to please present on the energy mapping and EV charging mapping for cities.
Sure. Thank you very much, Chaitanya. Good afternoon, everyone. I'll just be speaking about the energy demand mapping and the location of charging infrastructures in cities. So I'll just be sharing my screen. Is it visible, Himanshi?
Yes, Rohan.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Great. So just to give a brief context as to this whole analysis, this analysis was undertaken to calculate the charging demand for a city for the year 2020-2035. This was to facilitate, the future planning of the cities, like Chaitanya alluded to integrate into the urban planning of the city itself, trying to understand where the charging demand would arise in a city for the next 5 to 10 years. And also it'll help, by locating the chargers in these high demand areas. The other part is it will also help the electric distribution companies to kind of bolster their capacity of the electric grid infrastructure itself. So I'll just dive into our methodology. So this was the three-step methodology that we undertook. The first step was spatially locating the demand clusters based on certain assumed utilization levels. We took, the places where these EVs would be charged, predominantly in home, workplaces, and public charging. And I'll go into the details of all of this in the next few slides, but I just want to give an overview as to the steps. The second step is, estimating, this is the core data analysis that we have done, where we estimated the EV penetration levels for 2025 and 2030 for each vehicle segments of E2-wheelers, E3-wheelers, E4-wheelers, and the commercial ones, and assigned it to a grid. The next step was to estimate the energy needs to charge these EVs. So the next 5 years or 10 years, there'll be an increased number of EVs on the road. What would be the energy requirements to charge these EVs was the final step of our analysis. So for the first step of the geospatial analysis, what we did was we broke this. This was a analysis which undertaken for Hyderabad. So the city of Hyderabad was broken into 829 grids of 1 square kilometer each. Okay. And then the step two was trying to understand what are the different kinds of data sets we will utilize for home charging, for workplace charging, and public and destination charging. For the home charging, we took the data from the population count. And then the other set of data was the population with access to a two-wheeler and a four-wheeler. So which is like the vehicle ownership. The second one was workplace chargings, where we got all the data sets for government offices, the IT offices, and all the other offices where people will apply to from home. The third set of data sets were for the public and destination charging, where you would have the opportunity to set up a charger, probably in petrol stations and other public areas. And also important ones were the public transit areas, like metro stations, railway stations, and big bus depots. And we also took the data sets of points of interest, where people could spend, you know, probably drop their vehicles and for an hour or two, like shopping malls or movie theaters and other eateries as such. So this is how we were able to, like, you know, spatially graph it out. This was for every 1 square kilometer, the total number of people residing in this area. So you could see, like, there were some areas with less than 1,000 people to a maximum of around 40,000 people per square kilometer. The other way that we did was coming from whole to parts was we collected the census data, which is the vehicle ownership data. This is available at a sub-district level with households, with the number of households which have access to vehicles. We brought it down to a ward level. And then again, since we have broken the city into 829 grids, we brought it from sub-district level to ward level and then to the grid level. For this, we utilized the vehicular growth rate, which is put out by the Road Transport Yearbook by MoRTH, Government of India, and also estimations of world population growth from 2011 to 2020. And this is how we mapped out for the workplace location, like the ones like IT offices, which you can see in pink, and there were certain government offices and other offices where people would, like, you know, go with their two-wheelers or three-wheelers or four-wheelers. And there could be an opportunity for charging. The next set of data sets were, of course, the public places. You can see that, you know, there are the petrol pumps, numerous number of petrol pumps, bus depots, then public parking stations, and then movie theaters, and of course, the new set of metro rail stations, which are getting developed in Hyderabad. So after collecting the data, what we did was, the next step of analysis was, assuming that the private vehicles, this was based on extensive literature review and also speaking with multiple stakeholders, we found that for private vehicles, these vehicles will predominantly charge at home. So that is why what we have done is we have assigned certain weightages. So for home charging, we are assuming something between 60 and 80% of a charging will be done at home. Other 10% of charging will be done at workplaces when the people go to work. And other 10%, the remaining 10% would be done at public areas. So these were the number of data sets that we took into account, like population count, access to private vehicles, petrol stations and metro stations. And then they were, like, you know, provided the subsequent 80%, 10%, 10% weightages. Then what we did was, these are the absolute value of on each of these grid cells. So for example, that grid 134, the population for 1 square kilometer was 19,317. But in some areas, it could be 786, 2,500, going up to, you know, 45,600. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to normalize these numbers, because some areas there would be like very high numbers, some there would be very low numbers. So there could be like an extenuating numbers, which would actually throw the data analytic out of the range. So what we did was we normalized this value using a min-max normalization technique and brought all of them between 0 and 1. This was done for all the different data points, like number of offices in a grid, petrol stations, and so forth. After normalizing this, we multiplied the weightages of that 80%, 10%, 10%. With that, we would get the final demand score for each of this grid. And then this was then, you know, spatially located. Then you can see that in some areas, the scores were 0.05 to 0.5. This is for the E2 wheelers, the demand weightages for each of these grids. This was also done for private vehicles. For the commercial vehicles, we assume that the charging will predominantly be done in public. So the home and the workplace charging was not taken into account. All the weightages was provided to only the public data sets, like the petrol stations, metro stations, railway stations, and so forth. And following the same methodology, absolute values were then normalized, and then 100% of them were utilized to multiply with weightages, and the same spatial location was done. So you can see that while in the previous one, it was in the southern part, you could see the certain more demand, probably because of more population. Here, since we have taken only public data sets, the number of demand clusters for E3 wheelers or the commercial vehicles have slightly shifted. The next part of the analysis was trying to understand how many EVs would be there in 2025 and 2030. And for this, what we did was we broke it into different electric vehicle segments of E2 wheelers and E4 wheelers, which are private. and then E3-wheelers and E4-wheelers, which are commercial. Again, the vehicle growth rate was taken from, the road transport yearbook, the computed annual growth rate. And we did an analysis based on certain numbers from NITI Aayog, KPMG and WRI analysis. And we found that, you know, there would be 10% penetration rate of private E2-wheelers by 2025 and 35% of every, 100 vehicles sold would be EVs. And similarly, 3%, 15% for four-wheelers. And commercially, E3-wheelers, we found out that, the penetration could be as high as 40% in 25 and 70% of 2030. So based on this number and the penetration level, we calculated the number of EVs there would be by 2025 and 2030. And then, E2-wheelers, we foresee that there could be close to 2 lakhs. And 14 lakhs of E2-wheelers would be there by 2030. And 42,000 of E3-wheelers and 1.6 by 2030. And then we did an analysis of how much energy needs would be required for all of these different segments. So currently, there'll be the battery capacity of E2-wheelers around 2.5 kilowatt hour. And for E2-wheelers, it's 30.2. And we have assumed that, the daily energy driving needs would be about 40 kilometers. And the utilization of E3-wheelers would be as high as 120 kilometers. So having these data and trying to understand what will be the daily energy needs that we have done by battery capacity, by the amount of time it will take for the battery to be discharged. So we are assuming E2-wheelers, the amount would be 2 days based on the daily driving needs and the range of the battery itself. And for commercial E4-wheelers, you're assuming it will be around 1.81 days. So the total energy needs was calculated for each of these segments, for the E2-wheelers and the commercial ones. Then the next step was calculating the total daily energy needs. So what we did was, based on the number of EVs we have for 2025 and 2030 and the total energy required for home charging, workplace charging, public charging, we calculated how much would be required for the entire city. So, because the numbers of 45,000 and requirement of 4.7 kilowatt, the total energy needs was calculated for 2025 and 2030. But this was the energy required for all of the entire city. Now we wanted to bring it down to a granular level, since it was divided into 829 individual grids. What we did was we brought all of these from a top to the granular level of each of these 1 into 1 square kilometer grids. So what we did was we took the weighted score of each of these home charging, public charging, and workplace charging, and then tabulated the total weight of all of these grids. And the relative strength of the weights for each home charging score was then multiplied by the total daily energy required of the whole of the city. And then the daily energy need per grid was tabulated. So for example, you can see that if the weighted score was around 0.36, and the total daily energy need was around 2 lakh kilowatt. Calculating the relative strength of this grid at 440, it would require in 2025 up to 744 kilowatts. This was done for all the 829 individual grids. And this is how it was spatially located. So it looks. So the total daily energy needs for 2025 was like this. You could see that, in some of those central business districts of Hyderabad, the energy requirement could be as high as 9,000 kilowatt. This was taken into account the three different layers of home, workplace, and public charging. This is the total daily energy needs. And for 2030, you could see that, because of higher penetration, these business districts and across the city, the energy requirement could go as high as 36,000 kilowatt. The other part of how this energy demand calculation could be utilized is this is just one example of how much energy would be required only for public charging. So you could see that by 2030, for public charging, if you were to institute a public charger in areas, the central business district could see something around 15,000 kilowatt and 26,000 kilowatt. This would help the urban planning authorities of Telangana and Hyderabad to ascertain where the most number of chargers have to be instituted. And it will also help distribution companies to understand whether their distribution transformers and the electric grid capacity has to be bolstered. Are there energy requirement? So in the next 5 to 10 years, do the energy required fall within the threshold or with the infrastructure have to be like, you know, improved. So this kind of analysis will provide authorities with, you know, of foreseeing what kind of policy and also kind of, you know, technical assistance that the city needs to improve its charging infrastructure. So this is the whole analysis that we have undertaken. I'll stop here. And please, if you have any questions, do raise it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rohan. If anyone has questions, do ask them. Otherwise, I'm going to ask a couple of questions because I think that was a very... There we go. We have a question from Siddharth. What CUF do you see between now and 2025? Do you know what CUF is or?
No.
We'll Siddharth, can you expand on CUF for us, please? Charger utilization factor. Ah, okay. Rohan.
Yeah, I think we had done around 40 to 50%, I think, Chaitanya.
We started with a lower end of 15%, and we've done a couple of assessments for 25% and 30% as well. So we don't expect it to go beyond that at this point, Siddharth. Yeah, I mean, 25% is definitely on the higher end, and that's why we're assuming it for the 2025-2030 period. Right now, it is definitely around 7-8%. And some of the, when you're doing the business model calculation, your sort of low end starts at around 5% and goes up to 25%. One more question on the methodology that if we want WRI to conduct a similar assessment for our city. Rohan.
Sure. I mean, sure. We could do that. I think we are actually trying to replicate this framework. We started with Hyderabad, and we're also looking at, you know, replicating this to other cities. I think we have earmarked cities with greater than 4 million population currently. We have some cities in Maharashtra, a couple in Karnataka. We could definitely, like, you know, foresee doing one for Aurangabad also. Sure.
We'll be in touch, Aditya. Thank you for raising the query. On the methodology itself, how easy is it with respect to the data collection, Rohan? I think given that we have a lot of smart cities and city officials here, I think it might be useful for them to understand some of the sources and other issues, data issues we might find.
Sure. Yeah. So I think data is one of course, it's one of the key elements of this analysis. And we have tried to, like, you know, get as much as like in an open portal. I think Telangana had, like, for the registration numbers, they had an open Hyderabad portal, and we were able to get it. But some of those key data elements, like, you know, the census data, some of the data is still from 2011, like, you know, the household data and the access to two-wheelers were from 2011. And we have taken certain numbers and brought it, like, you know, 2020, 2021 numbers. So if we were to get those kind of numbers, you know, updated numbers, that would be great. And one of the other two critical elements, that we would love to have to make this framework even more robust is, one is the socioeconomic factors, you know, of median income. What would be the median income so that it helps us to understand the purchase parity. If people will be able to, like, you know, buy e-two-wheelers and four-wheelers, which might be a bit on a premium level. So it will get us, like, you know, a bit of robustness. The other one is the original data sets, you know, original destination data sets. This will help us also to understand where the more number of vehicles are plying in a city. So we'll try to understand the vehicular demand. And it will also help us, like, you know, get more understanding of whether public charges have to be put in this specific areas where more number of vehicles are, like, you know, going on a day-to-day basis. So these are the couple of other data points which would make it even more robust.
Thanks, Rohan. We can come back to any other questions people may have about the analysis towards the end, but now I'd like to invite Sushovan from GIZ to present on the different charging tenders that cities can undertake to actually implement EV charging.
Thank you, Chaitanya. There's one last question I see. Would you want to take that up or can I start?
Yeah, there are two questions from Vishali and Siddharth. So would you like to take it in the end or right now?
Let's take it right now. It also gives people a bit of breathing room. Is that all right, Sushovan?
Yeah, sure. No
problem. Rohan, one is, what is the rationale behind taking more weightage to residential charging over charging at public places?
Yeah, sure. So based on, you know, the assessment, and we've also spoken to stakeholders, and currently most of them feel that, you know, the biggest impetus in the EV market now has been the e-two-wheelers, right? The e-two-wheelers have taken a bit bigger penetration in the market. And we found out, and based on, I think, one of the surveys also which were done, we found that more number of people are wanting to, like, you know, would rather charge at home, especially with the e-two-wheelers, would rather charge at home than, like, you know, go to a public depot of sort, right? So that was one of the reasons why we took higher weightages. And also, I mean, this is not, there's also a range, right? So we've taken 60 to 80%. Based on the higher penetration we see over time of E3-wheelers, which we think will increase over the next years, we can, like, you know, change the weightages more to the public domain also. So that shift can happen. But for now, based on certain research and talking to stakeholders, we feel that more number of people, more customers are a bit more confident of just charging at home. So yeah, that's a rationale for private charging over public charging.
Thank you. There are a couple of other questions, but I think we can answer them in chat. They're fairly straightforward. So over to you, Sushovan.
Sure. Thank you, Chaitanya. Let me share my screen. So with the WRI team giving a overview around how charger planning needs to be done, I will give you a small snapshot of how Delhi government prepared its two tender documents. One is the public and the battery swapping tender, and another is the private charging tender. And firstly, GIZ, from GIZ side, we are happy to be part of designing the tender along with government of Delhi, and to be more specific, DDCD in designing this tender. So taking forward the key highlights from the public and the private charging tender, we'll take both together. First, the public and the battery swapping tender, mostly the tender was about establishing EV chargers at various locations. Around 100 locations have been identified under various location packages from A to J across NCT of Delhi. The nodal agency for this complete tender is Delhi Transco Limited, and you will find the tender dated 17th March 2021. The link has been provided here. I'm sure WRI team would be sharing the presentations. You'll be able to get the complete link, the complete document through this link, as well as the private charging tender. The second is the private charging tender. This is basically for a RFS document for selection of bidders for empanelment of players who can act as private charging infrastructure providers in NCT of Delhi. The nodal agency for this is a DISCOM, that is BSES Rajdhani Power Limited. The date of notification was around 14th July 2021. Same, the link is provided. The objective of designing the public charging tender was mostly to design a holistic charging network across Delhi, and a bit more specific for two-wheelers and three-wheelers, because the type of chargers that you see would, for which subsidy is being given, is mostly the slow chargers, but higher power chargers of capacity 22 kilowatt have also been considered in this. The rationale for designing the private charging tender was to design a single window mechanism under which any consumer can reach out through a portal for deployment of chargers within their own area of operations or in their own residential area. So these were the objectives. If we go through next, the operating model for public charging and the battery swapping tender, the operating model is Government of Delhi has identified around 100 locations for deployment of chargers. On these pre-designated areas, the concessionaire is allowed to install, operate, and maintain EV chargers, and no additional other commercial activity other than EV charging is allowed in these areas. Upon the end of the lease period, which is for 60 months and extendable to 24 months, the concessionaire will be allowed to take up the ownership of these charging infrastructure assets after they get an NOC from the land owning agency and the DISCOM. If I talk the similar thing for the private charging tender, there are two type of models that have been identified for the private charging tender. A CAPEX model, in which it's an upfront payment to the empaneled agency, which includes annual maintenance contract of 3 years. A subscription model is more, you can say, like a RESCO model that we have in solar, in which the empaneled agency will deploy, install, and maintain the chargers at your given area, but then you would be paying up an equal monthly installment, which is around a subscription fee, back to the empaneled agency. The subscription fee would also include your AMC, that is annual maintenance contract, as well as OMC, that is operations and maintenance contract, for 3 years. But for you to be able to get into a subscription model, you need to have a minimum of 10 EV charging points that are to be procured from the empaneled agency. The operating period, as I said, for public and battery swapping tender, the validity of the concessionaire lease agreement would be for 60 months, which is further extendable to 24 months. For the empaneled period, whereas the empanelment period for private charging tender is for 3 years, which shall be renewed every year based on your views and modifications from the consumers. Next, as I said, the type of chargers that are allowed in public charging and the battery swapping tender are slow AC 001 tenders, slow AC 001 chargers having a maximum output power of 3.3 kilowatt per charging point, and they have a total of three guns with AC 001. That makes it a total of 10 kilowatt charger having 3.3 kilowatt for each gun. Next is the moderate and the fast chargers, where one that is allowed, that is the DC001, having a total capacity of 15 kilowatt and one gun for it. And another one is a type 2 AC charger having a capacity of 22 kilowatt, or any other charger within this capacity range of 15 to 22 kilowatt is allowed under this tender document. Other than these chargers, battery swapping facilities have also been agreed upon under this tender document, which is primarily for two-wheelers and three-wheelers. But the minimum capacity of the battery swapping facilities need to be of at least 15 battery swapping docks under each battery swapping facility. And they should be able to service at least two OEMs of having different vehicle types. If I talk about the type of chargers allowed under the private charging tender, it includes the AC001, similar to the public charging tender, having a maximum output of 3.3 kilowatt per charging gun and a total of 3 points or guns. Another one is a low energy voltage AC single socket charger having a single gun of maximum output of 3.3 kilowatt. And next is the DC001 charger, the similar one in public charging tender, of 15 kilowatt maximum output. If I talk about the subsidy disbursement, under public charging tender, you get a one-time grant of 100% for slow chargers only, that is your AC001 chargers only, up to a maximum of ₹6,000 per charging gun. If it's a three-gun charger, that makes it a total of ₹18,000 per AC001 charger. Whereas in private charging tender, you get a similar one-time grant of ₹6,000 or 100%, whichever is applicable, for slow chargers, specifically AC001 and LAVAC chargers, but it has been capped to a maximum of first 30,000 charging points. If you are talking about the subsidy that is to be given for chargers to be deployed in semi-public units, it has been capped to a maximum of 20 charging points or 20% of their total parking slot, whichever is lesser. Next, as I said about the coverage in public charging, the coverage of this tender is for around 100 locations defined under packages A to J. And the list of these packages you will find in the complete tender document, which is linked before. Under private charging tender, there are two types of locations that have been identified. First is the semi-public sites, which includes commercial buildings, malls, offices, institutional buildings such as hospitals, colleges, group housing societies, and the kirana stores. And second, it includes private property buildings, that is your bungalows, apartments, and all. Next, the service level agreement. So specifically, a service level agreement has been provided in the public charging and the battery swapping tender, which says that the concessionaire must ensure a monthly uptime of 98%, whereas they should also ensure, or the public chargers should be operational for at least 16 hours a day. Now, since these are government identified lands, so it's sort of a PPP model, public-private partnership model, in which the concessionaires have to pay back the landowning agencies around 0.70 rupees per kilowatt hour as a fee for leasing out the land. Under private charging tender, no specific mention is there on the service level agreements. The agreements are mutually agreeable between the empaneled agency and the consumers. If I talk about the common details that are provided in both the tender documents, a common detail is the data sharing with the DISCOMs. So the chargers must be able to provide the following data points to the DISCOMs on a regular basis, which includes data points such as peak hours of charging, real-time power consumption, session start-stop, instantaneous current flow, and the various details that are given here. This is the last slide. So there are few user functionalities, communication requirements, and safety norms that are to be adhered to by the chargers and the charging station operators. Under public charging and battery swapping tender, these are predefined in the tender document, whereas under private charging tender, it is not specifically defined, but then every charger, that is the three type of chargers that have been defined, have their own user functionalities, communication requirements, and safety norms, which need to be adhered to. So these are part of the charger specifications, but no specific mention has been provided in the tender document. If I talk about the information that is submitted to the open database, under the public charging tender, DTL is preparing and would be managing an open database, and the licensee has a provision to provide information on the station level as well as the charger unit level data back to the DTL for an operational management of the chargers. But nothing specific like this has been mentioned in the private charging tender. So this is a small overview on the public and the private charging tender. Thank you from our side. And as I said, again, from DIS's side, we are glad to be part of the tender designing process for DDCD and Government of Delhi for both the public and the private charging tender. And along with that, I believe the WRI team has also been helpful for designing these tender documents along with us. Thank you. We can take up questions after this, Chaitanya.
Yeah, thanks, Sushovan. We have a question here. One from Abhi, which is asking, can you please elaborate on the ability to serve at least two OEMs, I think as a charger requirement? Do you mean two yes. different battery forms? Is it an obligation or a recommendation?
This is an obligation that has been given, and the ability to service two OEMs is, if there are two OEMs having two different battery sizes or battery forms, one battery swapping operator should be able to cater to both of those OEMs.
Right. So to ensure some amount of interoperability, basically.
Exactly.
Another question from Siddharth is, with reference to the DTL tender, could you please elaborate on the subsidies or waiving off of electrical infrastructure setup costs? Would DTL or GNCTD set up the transformer, or is the operator expected to set it up?
It is completely depend upon the DISCOM's supply grid code. If it is within the limits, of course, DISCOM would be providing you the infrastructure. If it is not, you will have to set up your own infrastructure. On the subsidies is on the cost of the charger. And on the cost of the charger, 6,000 rupees per charging gun is being provided. If just taking an example, if we are assuming an AC001 charger having three guns, each of 3.3 kilowatt, and the cost of that charger is say 50,000 rupees. So you will be getting a subsidy of 6,000 rupees into per gun, that is three guns, that is 18,000 rupees subsidy is what you would be getting for it.
Additionally,
the subsidy for additional infrastructure is not being given.
Right. I think from whatever I remember of the tender, though, each site will be provided 100 kilowatts of power for the operator. So, I mean, whatever infrastructure is required in that will be included. But essentially, they're providing a plug-and-play site of 100 kilowatts. If you require more power than that, then you're going to have to set it up yourself.
Set it up yourself.
How will another audience member is asking, how will issues of illegal parking obstructing access to the charger be dealt with realistically?
This is a very good question, but I guess this has not been dealt with in the tender document per se, very specifically. So I believe this is completely on the charging infrastructure operators who would be operating those chargers, rather than agreement that has been specifically kept as part of this tender.
Yeah, and that's why I think a lot of the discussion around spatial planning requires good urban parking policies. You want to ensure that you are providing these sites where there is organized parking. And as far as the DPL tender is concerned, that is the case. But at the same time, even then, even in organized parking, you find people parking quite illegally or in an obstructionist manner. And so better regulation of parking and enforcement of parking rules is going to be pretty critical if we're talking about public charging infrastructure provision, because chargers are going to be linked to parking.
Exactly.
One question from me, Sushovan, and that again might be illuminating for the city officials here, is what is the purpose the private charging tender is serving, as in what is it making easier, this empanelment? What do you see as the purpose of it, and why might cities want to take it up or DISCOMs want to take it up?
Okay, so to answer your small bit is, first, as you have shown in your previous presentations, that private charging will constitute around your maximum bit of the charging. That is, home charging will contribute to around 70-80% of the charging. Hence, developing a good private charging network is very important. Now, in a state like Delhi, mostly the housing areas are high-rise buildings, and people buy vehicles, but then how to deploy, which charger to deploy, what is the capacity of each charger is nowhere to be found. Means this is nothing that we can find easily over the internet. So as to enable people get an overview of the type of chargers and the type of charging infrastructure manufacturers or the OEMs present, this is a single window clearance mechanism in which Delhi government wants to develop a portal where a consumer can directly go to that portal, identify the type of charger that they need, and just, it's like you can, the way you use Amazon, you can just click on the type of charger you want and pay for it. The empaneled agency, whoever you choose, would get the order for deployment of charger. They will directly collaborate with the DISCOMs so as to deploy charger in your facility, rather than you going around and looking out for various players and understanding their functionalities or whatever services they are trying to provide. That is a one place shop for you to go through all the type of charging infrastructure operators. So in the end, it provides you an ease of deployment of private chargers within your area.
Great. I don't see any other questions right now. So I think we can move to the next presentation. Thanks, Sushovan. If there are any other questions, we can take them at the end.
Sure, Chaitanya. Thank you.
Now I'd like to welcome Mr. Ram Krishna, who is the project director at TS Redco, which is the Telangana State Renewable Energy Development Corporation, which is the state nodal authority for EV charging and electric vehicle deployment in Telangana and Hyderabad. Mr. Ram Krishna, over to you for providing a presentation.
Thank you, Chaitanya. First of all, I would like to say thanks to WRI for giving me this opportunity. And indeed, it's an honor and pleasure for me to be in this platform to share about the Telangana security in the electric vehicle part. So before start with, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Ram Krishna, project director for electric vehicle. We are the state nodal agency from the Telangana state. Just a few more. I hope everybody can see my screen, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
See, TS Redco, we are primarily responsible for installation of charging stations in the state of Telangana. So there are two models we are right now progressing on. One is FAME 1 and FAME 2 under the subsidizer scheme from the Government of India, under which the central public sector undertaking selected by DHI is doing this program. Second one is PPP model, like the way Delhi and Karnataka has adapted. We are planning to do a similar kind of model. Under FAME 1, we have received 30 chargers to be installed in various government organizations, which we have completed almost all 30. Under FAME 2, Telangana state has received 138 charging stations, of which 118 in Hyderabad, 10 in Karimnagar, and 10 in Warangal. This one, all the locations have been identified and handed over to the central public sector undertakings. The central public sector undertakings, who are the implementing agencies for this FAME 2, is REIL, NTPC, and EESL. So we have selected totally 230 locations and handed over to these three implementing agencies to shortlist the suitable locations based on the requirements. And as on date in Hyderabad, we have totally 70 public charging stations available, which includes both the government and private operators. I'm including the 30 also in this 70 numbers. TS Redco is planning to call for 600 numbers of charging stations in the next 3 years under PPP model. And in this, we are closely working with WRI and Administrative Staff College of India in identifying the locations and citing the suitable locations, not only in Hyderabad. This we wanted to do it in entire Telangana state, primarily identifying the suitable highways and ensuring that this model is spread across the state. So, as you all know, Telangana ERC has determined 6 rupees as a tariff under a special category for EV. And this has got its own advantages, like none of the other states have done it. We have introduced the TOD in EV segment. So, in non-peak hours, the tariff in peak hours it is 7, and there are no fixed charges per month, MD charges, which has been one of the most attractive tariff which has been announced by the government. And as a nodal agency, we have signed the MOUs with all these three agencies and also the private participations who are interested in setting up of the charging stations in the state. And we have amended the municipal acts for promoting the charging stations. All the commercial buildings have to be equipped with 20% of the parking slots with EV. Out of the total parking, 20% should be on EV. So this has been already enacted, and we are working on the residential side also. We won't mandate it, but we will give the provision. Let's say if in any apartment or a group houses, if the association is not allowing the any individual interested resident to come up with a charging for his own captive need, and if it that they are causing any sort of objections and all, so we wanted to protect the interest of those residents. We are enacting the suitable clauses so that his interest for the migrating from IC to EV is well protected through this kind of things. We will not mandate. It will be initially on a voluntary basis. Commercial we are mandating. But domestic side, we will advocate them for the advantages. Slowly, we will be start mandating the EV charging stations. All the locations which we have identified are basically the urban local body areas. That is Greater Hyderabad Municipal Corporation premises and the Hyderabad Metro Development premises, including the outer ring roads, which is spread across close to 160 kilometers by the distance wise, and within the city all the public parking locations and the malls and everything have been identified, and these locations have been handed over to these things. So urban local bodies, that is municipal and urban development, energy department, that is TS REDCO, and the industries department, who has given the policy, and the transport department, we have formed as a steering committee in the state. And the steering committee will be monitoring the progress of the policy implementation in the state from time to time. And under the policy, we have given certain subsidies from the demand side and the supply side. Suppose if the demand side, the subsidies have exhausted, so the steering committee will take the suitable steps to ensure that the numbers are enhanced. We will make the recommendation to the government for enhancing the numbers. So this is how the policy implementation and the charging stations implementation is happening in the state. Then we are also coming up with the swapping stations in the state for the retrofitment of the autos. We are coming up with a policy under which the swapping stations also will be encouraged, and these swapping stations and the charging stations both will be available in the upcoming 600 charging stations which we are trying to call for on PPP model. You all know we have total 5 protocols for fast, moderate and slow. So the charging stations under FAME 1 will be having all these five protocols which are available, and also the charging stations which we are trying to call on PPP model will be having not only the concept of charging station, there will be a charge points also, where there is no provision from the electricity point of view for a charging station to be given. There we are encouraging a charge point. At least the charging can be promoted. Recently, Niti Aayog is also felt the same in terms of promoting the charge points in place of charging stations where there is no feasibility for charging stations. So we are also thinking in similar lines to encourage these charge points. As on date, these are the charging stations that are right now available in Hyderabad in various government offices. These are open for public within that government offices and for their captive needs. As a REDCO, to encourage the adoption of the electric vehicle, we have come up with a tender in which WRI is a part of it in preparing this tender document. This tender, we have called for the empanelment of agencies for providing the four-wheelers on higher basis to various government departments on monthly usage basis. So closely 1,000 vehicles have been empaneled. Two agencies have been empaneled, and 1,000 vehicles is the total number under this tender. So slowly we are migrating all the higher vehicles in Hyderabad in various government offices from the IC to EV. So before we wanted to do that, we ensured all these government offices has the charger, whether it is DC001 or AC001 or the combo charger with the CCS and the type 2 AC, they are all made available in the respective departments so that they don't feel charging is a barrier for them to go further. And also the upcoming 138 charging stations under FAME 2, will also be made utilized to ensure these 1,000 vehicles are put to usage for charging purposes. Thereby, what will happen? The occupancy today, whatever we are talking, while making the financial models, we are considering around 5%, 3%, 2%, 1% and all. We wanted to ensure that not only the charging infrastructure is promoted, but also we wanted to ensure this are put to operationalized so that the occupancy of these chargers will be high and the operator doesn't feel a kind of burden. At the same time, the tariff also, whatever the tariff for this charging station that we are trying to propose, will be very much reasonable to the public. Thereby, it will be a kind of a win-win situation to all the ecosystem. We are almost all concluded about the cost of service to be determined under FAME 2 in Telangana. So mostly by next week or so, we will be submitting our proposals to the ERC for determination of the cost of service, cap on the cost of service. And in this state, we are trying to see that the charging infrastructure picks up as a business model in the true sense, just not for the sake of implementation wise, but we wanted to see that the returns also be there, either it is the central public sector agencies or the private participations. Then when this system comes into a true economic sense, automatically the business expands, the charging stations will come up, thereby we will really go for electric. These are the charging stations which are available for our buses. Right now, 40 buses are plying in Hyderabad. Under FAME 2, Rajasthan Electronic Instruments Limited have been given totally 57 charging stations, 37 in Hyderabad, 10 in Karimnagar, 10 in Warangal. NTPC, 32 in Hyderabad. Energy Efficiency Services Limited, 49. These are the charging stations and we have completed the siting of the locations. And you all know, majorly all are under category A. Very few are, maybe around 5 to 6 are in category B. And all the surveys have been majorly completed for these locations. And as a first lot of chargers from the under FAME 2, they are expected to reach Hyderabad end of this month. So we will be starting the construction of these charging stations by first week of October. We have already signed the MOUs with all the agencies, implementing agencies. TS Redco will support them by partnering for doing the maintenance activities for the promotion of this electric vehicle charging stations. All the locations were given by HMDA, that is Hyderabad Metro Development Authority, which is a ULB 136, including parks, public places and everything. Greater Hyderabad Municipal Corporation, 50 locations. Southern DISCOM given 54, Northern DISCOM given 45. With the support of WRI, we have done this siting. So this is how the charging stations, which is going to be spread across in the state. This is not finalized, almost all, this is almost 90%. But at the time of construction, we will try to see that the alignment, if we want to change it, we will change from the usage point of view based on the traffic data. So this was done post pre to COVID scenario. Post COVID scenario, there are certainly certain changes which has happened even in the transport wise. So if sort of changes are required, we are hoping that we will make the changes for these locations also. This is the penetration of each charger wise. Again, this is with support of WRI, we have done it. We could able to sense which charger will be having the most occupancy from the minimal of 15,000 people to a maximum of 110,000 areas, pockets wise, we have identified and we have sited these chargers. And just now I told, one of the initiative for encouraging the electric mobility is providing office vehicles to offices, which is Telangana is the only state which is doing it as an independent agency. I know ESL also is supporting this kind of, but this is truly like we will not be spending any capex on buying of the vehicles. The agencies will be doing it, thereby it is a business model for them. the vehicle will be given on a hire basis. We have predominantly done the split of the vehicles on a range wise. Initially, when we have done it, it was between 100 to 200 as one segment, 200 to 300, 300 to 400. We have done it with driver and without driver, but which includes the kilometers, free kilometers within the packages are given. We are empaneling them for 5 years. Every year we will be extending the contract with them. These are the vehicles that we are proposing them. Second one is retrofitment. We have targeted under the Telangana state EV policy, there are 5,000 autos announced under subsidy for retrofitment category. So we are targeting to ensure that this retrofitment is done it on a phased manner. Thereby, we will be providing the retrofitment subsidy of 15,000, and the battery swapping operators will be spending the balance amount, and they will recover the money towards the capital investment through each time charging. Thereby, what will happen? The pollution levels of Hyderabad will definitely get under clean air pollution program. This is one of the key initiatives we are trying to propose. This will help the EV adoption on a very faster pace. Second one is providing two-wheeler on EMI basis to all government employees in the state. We are targeting somewhere around 1 lakh two-wheelers to all government employees on EMI without any down payment. You all may be knowing that yesterday Kerala has started this program. AP will be doing it. We will be launching this program very shortly. The procedure is under approval of government. So this is how. The cost of EMI will be much lesser than the cost of the maintenance of the vehicle. And one advantage with this is from government side, there is no single investment, 1 rupee investment from the government side. Everything will be done by the employee. We are in the process of developing of an app for the operation of all these FAME 1, FAME 2 and charges set under PPP model. So this app will be made available to the public to operate the chargers. And the second one is we wanted to encourage three-wheelers for garbage collections in ULBs. We are trying this model in a ULBs in a semi-urban areas to start with. So that wherever there are existing autos under IC side, we will be doing a retrofitment and converting them to the EV. And the second one is the new one. So whoever has got the budget, we would like to give them the option for doing this one. And TS Redco will do the aggregate of the three-wheelers and everything for doing this business models. Recently, we have conducted a Go Electric campaign, which is a roadshow, which is a most successful one. This is the physical roadshow we have conducted. Around 45 companies have been participated, starting from two-wheelers to three-wheeler, four-wheeler, autos, the charge point operators, swapping station providers, and everybody. This is the roadshow that we have conducted. This is the local media which has come up with. We have done even rally also on that day, EV rally, to create awareness. And to be very honest with you, after this event, the public opinion have got changed a lot. They were whatever the doubts that they had, they could able to clarify it, and the sales also really picked up after the announcement of EV policies and incentives from the demand side. And we have allotted 500 number of electric vehicles under SCST scheme on a subsidized model to unemployed youth for promotion of electric vehicle mobility in state. we are trying to see that wherever there is a possibility, National Clean Air Program funds have been also utilized for promotion of this electric vehicle charging stations. So this is predominantly the Telangana side, whatever the progress that we are right now doing it and the new proposals we are trying to work out, this is how we are planning to do.
Thank you, Mr. Ramakrishna. We have one question here from Animesh. Animesh is asking, to substitute the consumption of these chargers from the grid, is there any mandate to power the chargers using solar panels, at least in the government buildings?
See, as per the policy of DHI and the state, it was clearly announced that the renewable energy has to be promoted for these charging stations. But you all know that because of the constraints on the locations, proper rooftop availability is not there, or open access issues are there. That's why we are not forcing them. But wherever there is a possibility, we are asking them to do it on a voluntary basis. So going forward, we will ensure that certain portion of the energy has to come from renewable energy. That's what we will do it.
All right, thank you. And one question is, what is the currently the what at least our observation has been is, because there are so many agencies, there is land agency, there is the power DISCOM that provides the power, there is a lot of coordination required to actually apply for charging or a public charger. So wanted to understand what role TS Redco is playing in that, and how, if you are a charge point operator, how would you apply for charge, to set up a charge point or a charging station in Hyderabad or any other place in Telangana?
Okay. We, being a nodal agency, we are taking a role of coordination with various departments. We are working like a single window operator. But that is for frame two. But under private participation, if the private operator who wants to set up the charging station in his own private premises or any private premises, since it has been classified as a de-licensing activity, they need not come to any nodal agency to take the approval, except the data sharing, that since we are responsible to give the information to the Central Electricity Authority about the consumption of the power for the electric vehicle side, we will be asking them the data to be shared. Otherwise, they can straight away go to the DISCOM, apply for an electric vehicle connection, and for a public charging station, then they can go ahead in this regard. But under PPP model, what we are talking, there we will be giving the locations. Locations will be provided by the REDCO, and the charging provider will provide the, install the charging station in those areas.
Understood. Are there any other questions for Mr. Ramakrishna right now, or for any of the other speakers, now that we're coming to the close? I think, yeah, so thank you, speakers. I think we don't have any further questions. So before handing over to Manjari to close the session from NIUA side, I will just request everyone also to know that the next session of the Climate Change and Cities series will be taking place on 9th September on mitigation of GHG emissions, the self-assessment tool and a training session. So now I'd like to hand over to Manjari to conduct the closing for the session. Thank you. Thank you everyone for attending.
Thanks, Chaitanya. I hope I am audible.
You're audible.
Great. So I'll just quickly share my screen for a quick feedback round.
We can't see your screen anymore, Manjari.
I'm just going to share the details on the chat box so that the participants can quickly log in. So the details are on the chat box. I would request the participants to quickly log on to www.menti.com and use the code 7725-3809, or they can directly use the link given on the chat box so that they can access the Mentimeter quickly. I hope my Menti screen is visible.
Yeah.
Great. So let's take a couple of seconds so that the participants can join on to Menti, www.menti.com, and use the code 7725-3809. Great. So moving on to the first question. On a scale of 1 to 5, how would you rate the session of the following parameters? The parameters being relevance and usefulness of the content, ease of understanding, question answer session, and interaction with the speakers. Great, I think we have a good number of participants there. So moving on to the next question. What are your key takeaways from this particular session? You could write a sentence or a couple of words to express your takeaways. Just a sentence or a few words would do, I guess. So I see practical information being the key takeaway. Definitely an interactive session. Policy, the market size. Importance of private charging station, PPP model, etc. And definitely the session was informative. So moving on to the next question. Any other suggestion if the participants have to enhance the e-learning series experience? Again, this is a short answer type question. You could drop in a sentence or a couple of words which you would like to suggest, and we would be able to incorporate this in our future learning session series. We could wait a couple of seconds so that other participants are able to drop in their suggestions. I think we have a couple of answers, and meanwhile, the other participants are answering this. We can close the session. And so So I would like to thank all the participants on behalf of WRI India as well as National Institute of Urban Affairs. Thank you so much for participating in today's session, and we would like to see you all in our next upcoming session, which is on 9 September, as Chaitanya had already mentioned. Thank you so much once again.
Thanks all.
Thanks everyone.
Thank you, everyone.